tuning in to the online broadcast network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads in over 150 countries and your number one source for after-show entertainment. Johnson. TV, the destination for TV superfans, producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows, interviewing celebrities and showrunners, and bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
I love that music. Hello, everybody, and welcome to a special Wednesday night edition of Survivor After Show on AfterBuzz. This season, we've been doing it on Thursday nights, but well, let me explain myself first of all. Hi, my name is Nando Velasquez. I am not usually on this show. Those of you who do watch AfterBuzz may have seen me on some other shows, but I'm usually not on this one. Our usual host, Justin and Jerry and Ryan are all, you figure they're probably celebrating, they're traveling. I'm not even sure where they are. But, you know, considering it's the holiday week, we're a little light-staffed, and I'm a big passionate fan of Survivor, so hopefully you will allow me to go into your homes, into your computer screens, into your iTunes, and discuss this week's episode. Usually in the, at least the first couple of seasons, I don't remember Survivor ever really doing a Wednesday night edition right before Thanksgiving. It's usually a clip show, a best of show, and I am so it's so unfortunate I'm here by myself to do this because it was such an amazing episode. And again, this isn't even our normal time, so even the people who probably are tuning into us live on AfterBuzzTV.com may not be sure about this. But if you are tuned in, if you are listening, just because I'm by myself and there's a lot to talk about, I do have the chat room open. I actually also have my Twitter account open. And you know what? We're also going to take some calls. So here's the number. It's 424-256-1729, totally opening to having a conversation regarding the show. Again, you guys may not know me from Survivor, but trust me, I've watched every single episode. I'm not going to go over my whole credentials on the show, but I'm a really, really huge fan. Let us begin with this episode. The name of this episode is This Is Where We Build Trust, and wow. This is definitely based on that tribal council. There is no trust going on at all. It was a very, very awesome episode. One thing that we definitely got to see in the previews and the clips from previously on Survivor was the fact that there have been no idols played at all this season. And the fact that Jeff narrated it was very odd that seven people have gone and there's no idols at all that have been played. We know about the one that John Rocker sat on, and that was back in play. So there were three idols. For those of you who didn't remember the one about Natalie and Baylor getting the clue, that one was still in play someplace on the island. And the other two were being claimed by John and Keith. But, you know, between you and me, I'm going to add a little commentary here when I can so that it's not just completely facts. Before this episode, I just didn't see Keith ever playing it. I really thought Keith would probably end up going home with an idol. And John as well, actually, especially seeing him this episode, the first half of this episode, how cocky he has become. He's been so used to being the center of attention, the swing vote, being able to call which alliance he can be on, that, you know, he's obviously feels that he's in the driver's seat. And we see from the post-tribal council, when we see the night vision shots going on, we definitely see that John is the main subject of conversation amongst a couple of the survivors, in particular Reed, who's trying to make up his mind on which alliance he should jump on, and Natalie, who feels betrayed after being blindsided, since she was Jeremy's biggest ally, and they were pretty much their own couple at this point, and she was feeling very threatened. We also got to see that John revealed that he had an idol to Natalie, and also to Baylor. According to the previews, John only let Jacqueline and Missy know. So now the five-person alliance all knows, and John says to Natalie that he's telling her this information because he has complete faith in her and he trusts her. Meanwhile, we also see that Natalie wants to get him out as soon as possible, possibly after another tribal council, though at least one more away. More on that later. So that's pretty much what we were dealing with post-tribal council from last week. Let's talk a little bit I'm just pulling this up right now. Let's talk a little bit about the reward challenge, because that was the next big thing that we saw. So first of all, it's your typical reward challenge around this point in the game. It's going to be two teams up against each other. You know, it was pretty, I don't want to call it necessarily generic, but it was your typical one. You're diving, you're swimming, you're climbing, you're jumping to get a key and get puzzle pieces. Of course, it all ends in a big puzzle. The one thing, I was engineering the show that Ryan Hooks was on with Justin, and that one, I remember, was a schoolyard pick. Again, this was a schoolyard pick. Very, very interesting. It was a schoolyard pick, and you know, it's a shame that we don't get to see exactly how they do it, because I think there's a lot, especially if you look at these teams and you think about the reward, looking at this team, that the two teams that were picked, it would really be interesting to see who were the two captains, because I would assume that's how they do the schoolyard pick. I would assume that they would actually do a random pick for who gets to be the captains, and based on the teams that were selected, Team Yellow being John with Jacqueline, Alec and Reed. It seems to me that maybe John was the captain, because obviously his girlfriend's on the team and he's got two able-bodied guys, and it seems to me like that. And then the blue team had Missy, Baylor, Natalie, so three women, and Wes. So based on that, I think the same thing. I feel like it would have to probably be, there's very few couples on this, in this game at this point, and I feel like Missy most likely would be going for the girl power in a schoolyard pick. You figure they're going back and forth. You would have thought that it would have been a little more even between the men and the women. So Missy, Baylor, Natalie, and Wes being the only guy on Team Blue, and the one person that was left off in a team of nine, one person was not going to be up for the reward, and that was going to be Keith. So it pretty much makes sense based on the two teams. I would assume that depending on who the captains were, Keith probably would have been picked over one of the women, not because of any particular reason with in regards to his own ability, but just the way these guys are this season. These guys really, you know, we've seen it a couple of episodes ago, you know, they do kind of have this frat boy mentality, and I think they would definitely pick someone in their 50s over Baylor, for example, since a couple of the guys have definitely shown they don't really care for Baylor as much. Anyway, so very, very neck and neck competition. You know, really, really good. I will totally admit, I was rooting for team. I like to root for the underdog. And also, obviously, I think I'm not the only person that could say this, but, you know, even though John seems to be playing a really good game, I think at this point, you can't help but root against him, which was really, really interesting considering so far the whole beginning of the episode was all about people talking trash about getting John out. So I was definitely rooting for the women and Wes, and you know, the way it started out looked really, really good. I mean, you know, we had Wes beating John in the first leg, and more or less it was slowly starting to deteriorate until Yellow finally took over. The big thing at the end with the puzzle, when all the teams were out, was Wes was the person in charge of the keys, and only one of the four keys that each team got was going to work on the platform. So Wes, unfortunately, or fortunately, whatever, however you want to look at it, had control of the keys. And while I believe it was Natalie that was trying to calm him down and have him, it was Baylor, I think, that was focused, if I remember correctly. I don't know if I wrote it here. But, you know, anyway, you know, Wes just couldn't handle the pressure, and he just could not handle it. And it was Baylor, actually, I believe. Yes, it was. So Yellow ends up running away with it. I got to be honest with you. I was rooting for Blue, and I really, if you asked me before the competition started, I would have assumed Blue would have won, just because I really felt that Blue had the smarter team out of the four. You know, just I feel like the women are definitely, Missy and Natalie in particular, are a lot smarter, I think, than some of the guys on the Yellow team. And yeah, I think what ended up probably ruining it was just all that time that Wes wasted being nervous. He was probably using the same keys again, for all you know. It was pretty funny. So I didn't really go over the reward. It was a really interesting reward. And we'll talk about it once the team that wins gets there. But it was a reward where the winning team gets to go and give baseball equipment to children in Nicaragua who are in need. Baseball being the number one sport in Nicaragua. And then the winning team was also going to win. They're going to eat baseball food. So really interesting. And obviously, I'm sure for a reward like that, the men in particular probably wanted to win this. They definitely had more fire to win this overall. So the men win it. One interesting note, Reed playing his ass off for the past 2 weeks. Excuse me. Reed playing his butt off for the past 2 weeks. Decides to do something. Now, we saw it last week. We saw it with Jeremy and Natalie. They gave up their spot on the winning team to give it to two people in need that they felt they were in need. Personally, since I wasn't on the show last week, I could say John and Jacqueline, they were not in need. But at the time, Jeremy and Natalie wanted to reward their good behavior and wanted to, for being in their alliance at that time and gave up their spots. We saw already how that came to bite Jeremy in the butt at the end of the episode. So, you know, based on that, and I know there's been lots of conversations, I definitely saw Probst had a big conversation about it on EW last week, about karma not necessarily being good. Many examples of people giving away rewards, giving, you know, a spot up, and then getting blindsided, then getting betrayed by the people that they actually gave their reward away to. So we see that. It's pretty unfortunate. But Reed, you know, and he's playing, I gotta admit, he's playing smart. I wish there was somebody here. There's definitely a spot where we can talk about this a little bit more to see exactly what Reed's thinking at the time. If he made a good move in that moment, if that was smart, what people would think, like what Jerry would think. Because, you know, after seeing what happened with Jeremy, I really would be hesitant for anybody to give up their spot like that. I think the first thing that really bugged me a little bit was, and I mean this just in a strategic way, was Baylor crying once Team Blue lost. Baylor was really in tears. She just won a reward last week. I had a feeling she was going to say it was because of her mom. And I think that's nice and that's fair. But, you know, showing that, it's just, I think it's just a sign of weakness for her. And you know, trying to get her mom to win one and get some food. I mean, it's admirable, but I don't know if you're really doing anyone any favors showing that emotion. Reed picked up on it though, and I got to give kudos to Reed. He gave Missy his slot. Again, putting him at risk. He already is at risk. We know that he's playing in a very, very conniving game right now, a very surprisingly conniving game, and. You know, and he's probably got the target on his back. I think he's got the target on his back because of his own doing. At least before we were watching the show, when Josh was still in it, it seemed like all of the edits were going Josh's way. So very surprisingly, you know, Reed was very, very invisible. And now we go pretty much, it was like, it's with Reed, in my opinion, it's been like from zero to 80 with him. He's been scrambling the past 2 weeks since Josh has been gone. And I, don't get me wrong, it's made for a very interesting show the past couple of weeks. It's definitely given some life into this show where I think a lot of people were thinking this was one of the lesser seasons. Just to see all the scrambling and see the blind sides the past 2 weeks and see what's been going on, you know, he's definitely added to that on a year when it seems like, two of the biggest players get knocked out in the middle of the game. So kudos to him. Kudos to his move. And it makes sense when you see what he does with the power that he gave away to end up being back on camp and to, you know, put his feelers out and try and set his plan to get rid of John in motion. Let's talk a little bit about the before we do, let me get a little bit of a break here and let me talk about iTunes. This is not my usual show, but you know, we do have about 80 different shows here on iTunes. If you have subscribed to this show on AfterBuzz, thanks so much for subscribing. Please rate us, comment us on us. You don't have to rate about this particular show. It's a Thanksgiving show, but you know what? We want to hear from you. You can also comment on YouTube and we'll gladly answer that. When you give us high ratings. It tells our bosses, Maria Menounos and Kevin Undergaro, how good a job we're all doing here. And it keeps the lights on. And it also, in general, it supports all of the shows on AfterBuzz in getting great guests, in getting cast members, in doing the kinds of shows that you want to hear. So welcome you to do that. Please, you know, we'd love to hear your input. Feel free to come on and post on iTunes or on YouTube. Okay. And again, we do tons of shows here. If you're not familiar with AfterBuzz, we do everything from Arrow to, you know, to Walking Dead. So all the top cable shows, all the top broadcast shows. And again, we appreciate you for listening in, especially this week for me on a holiday week. Anyway, let's move forward. Let's start talking about, well, let's talk about the reward challenge. I thought it was a very interesting reward challenge, first of all. You know, I love the challenges. Excuse me a second. Just pulling out. Just wanted to check something. I love the these reward challenges in a sense because I love the ones where the tribates are giving to, you know, where it's very charitable. I do think they get a lot out of that. And I think it's just a really awesome thing to see. This one was really, really interesting because I think it was, it was kids and, you know what, kids need to play baseball. It's different than kids, I guess, giving kids food or giving kids some other things. You know, and I'll tell you why I think that's a little bit weird at one point. But so the gang comes in and they give baseball gear to these kids. And it's, I gotta admit, it was really, really nice to see. And the person that I think really got the most out of it at that moment was Missy. So, I mean, it was great that she got to go on this, and it was great for her to experience this. Her being a single mother, her having kids of her own, I think she really gave motherly, some motherly love to those kids by handing out all that stuff with just such joy in her eyes to do that. So I think out of all the food rewards, I think this one was a particularly rewarding one to her. It also seemed at least that John and Jacqueline were getting a lot out of this too. We got to see a nice, vulnerable, emotional side to John and Jacqueline. I think his edit up to about a week or so ago has been kind of bumbling and kind of egotistical. And, you know, if it wasn't for Jacqueline, I think he'd totally be absolutely pegged as one of the frat boys along with Alec and Wes. You know, but he definitely gets to show, you know, a nice warm side, you know, treating the kids and talking about his own desire to have kids with Jacqueline and the challenge, the struggles that they have that because she can't have kids. And I think it really was a very humanizing, a really nice moment with John and Jacqueline. And I got to say, you know, overall, this episode, John has had a really good edit this episode. And I really think, you know, a couple of weeks ago, I said he wasn't playing too smart. I think Justin definitely felt that way, too. When he got the idol a couple of weeks ago, you know, he gained some credibility in my eyes. His moves last week to get rid of Jeremy, you know, as much as I hated that because I loved Jeremy, you know, it definitely showed that he is smarter than he is at least shot on screen, made to look on screen. It was a good move at the time. And now here we get to see another side of him. We don't really get to see much of Alec, but knowing Alec, he's probably just goofing around with the kids. The one thing I had I don't want to say a problem with, but one thing I thought was really, really weird was, you know, you have these guys after they give everything out and they're watching the baseball game that the kids are playing, and all of a sudden comes their, you know, their food in paper bags, and you see them all picking out on food, which they earned. And you see, if you look, you see kids in the background not eating. And I thought that was just a little odd, especially when you see that one kid. For a moment, it was kind of sad seeing that one kid wanting ice cream. And then John gave it to him, which made him feel good. So that was pretty appreciative. Anyway, moving on. So, you know, so the winning tribe is having a good time and they're feeling really, really well. Well rested, and they're feeling spiritually relieved from helping out these kids. On the other side of the equation, the other four that did not get to go to tribal council, to the reward challenge, pardon me, which were right now were Keith. Well, actually, it's four and Keith. So, I'll time out. Hold on a second. So we had two teams there that were back at the thing. Forgive me a second. I'm just running a mile a minute here. We had Natalie, we had Baylor, we had Keith, and we had Reed. So those four were back because I forgot to mention that Wes was sent to Exile Island out of the bunch. And you know what? Before we talk about that, we didn't really get to see Wes in Exile Island, but I think I was really curious to see why John sent Wes out of everybody else, especially after, and he was the one calling the shots on that, which I thought was really interesting, especially since, one of the main reasons why Jeremy was sent home, at least we were meant to believe, was because Jeremy went to Exile Island and John knew that Jeremy was going to figure out everything about the immunity idol. So I'm guessing that John sent Wes because he probably felt that out of everybody, Wes was the least threatening. Maybe he felt Wes couldn't find the idol. I have a feeling that was probably part of it. Anyway, moving forward, let's talk about the foursome that are back at camp. So I'm taking a little sip here. And hold on one second. Just checking to see if anyone has tweeted. All right. Anyway, so we're back at camp. We split up into two groups. This I thought was kind of funny. You got Natalie and you got Baylor, and then you got Reed with Keith. And both of them are trying to isolate somebody else in the group. It was like the easiest thing they could do. They were probably both nervous about having people listen in on their conversations or follow them around, and it was just so easy. So Reed pretty much says with Keith, they're going to go get fishing nets, and Natalie says, me and Baylor are going to get water, and they split up. So on one side, and what's even funnier about this whole thing is they both pretty much want the same thing, more or less, at this point. And here they are doing two different plans to implement them. We see Reed talking to Keith. This is really interesting because I feel that one of the reasons why Josh ended up getting voted out, I think, was really because of his alliance. He had a loyal alliance, but they weren't a very smart or alliance. And the way they treated Jacqueline, perfect example. Here's an example of Reed putting a lot of weight on Keith. Reed knows that Keith is not as keen to the intricacies of the game so far. And like I said, I even felt like Keith was going to be going home with an idol at some point. He just wasn't going to play it because he just doesn't know how. And also Keith just getting very defensive whenever the target even looks like it's going to get on him. So Reed is talking to Keith, and it's a pretty smart plan considering Reed is still playing both sides and feels comfortable getting into either side. Reed's plan is to convince the Alliance of Five that Keith or Wes have the idol, which of course they do, and convince the Alliance of Five that him and Alec were going to go along with them to get to flush the idol out and or to get rid of Keith and or Wes. But meanwhile, Reed's plan was to keep his four frat boy alliance back together from the start. So it was going to be Alec and Keith and Wes and Reed all voting John out, while the Alliance of Five, being Missy, Baylor, Natalie, John, and Jacqueline, were going to split their votes, assuming that they also had Reed and Alec on their side. Pretty genius plan. And what it does also, too, is it also keeps Keith's idol. Because, Keith doesn't have to flush the idol out, totally secure. What it relied on, and what seemed to be backfire later on in Reed's plan, was it relied on complete 100% willingness to trust Reed and willingness to play act and go along with anything, to feel completely at ease with the plan and not deviate from it. And that was required from Keith and even from Alec. And that's actually, even when I was watching that scene, I felt that was a pretty tall order for Keith. Keith is not the kind of person, he's very by the book, and I think he takes everything at face value. I was actually even surprised to see that Keith, at least in the confessional, was saying that it was a smart plan. Because I honestly didn't think Keith would have seen it 100% that way. I think a lot of people would have trouble with it just because you're pretty much asking somebody who has an immunity idol to let people vote for them and to not play your idol. And it is a risky move. In Keith's defense, I think if anybody was playing it, playing in his spot, if I was even playing in his spot, you know, that's a lot. That's a lot of trust. That is definitely a lot of trust for Keith. Anyway, so that's the plan on Reed's end, and the plan is to get John out. On the other side of the camp, back at the camp, actually, Natalie convinces Baylor to start looking for that idol. They have their clue. They figured out, most likely, that the idol is going to be somewhere really, really close to the flag that they have at home base. And, of course, Natalie's intention is to get that idol, to have that for herself. And I believe that only Baylor will know about it, or only Baylor at this point knows about it once they get it. And for them to vote out Reed first, or one of the other guys in that frat boy for some alliance, and then be able to vote John out the following week. They end up getting the idol, which is awesome, which is great. How brilliant. It's actually at home base. I'm really surprised. I would be really surprised if all of the cast members watching tonight's show would be watching this and realize that most of them probably sat right on top of the idol for most of the time they were on the island. I don't necessarily look. Natalie's a great player. I don't necessarily agree with the plan, only because there's one thing that at least based on the confessional that she hasn't really acknowledged yet that we're not sure about. If she was to vote Reed or one of the guys out like she did, and then go for John next week, she wanted to wait to get John out so that there would be a majority woman. The women would have the majority on the island. But I think the one flaw in her plan is at this point, not looking ahead, would be the fact that John has Jacqueline. So she would not want to vote for John out unless there was a big, really, really big reason. So, and Natalie, you know, Natalie even going up to Jacqueline with that kind of plan puts a big target on her back. So I think that would have been the one major flaw in Natalie's plan. And based on what we saw at the end of the show, you know, we'll see how that plays out if her plan goes through. Anyway, so that's what happened there. Let's go really quickly to the immunity challenge, as that was really, really cool. Hold on a second. Yeah, forgive me because I can't read both the chat room and this place. Anyway, so we're at the immunity challenge, and this is a typical endurance challenge. Really, 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 really fun. Really, really interesting. I don't know about fun. Really fun to watch, because of course, for two reasons. You know, you get to see these people really, really pushing their bodies to the limit to keep their feet on those perches and to keep their hands above their heads holding those handles. And then, of course, this is the challenge where Jeff decides to tempt them with food, which obviously adds a really great element to it. This is where we get to see who really is fighting for immunity and who really feels they're in danger and who feels safe. And we also get to see where everyone is in their alliance, who is cocky and overconfident and who thinks they're not going home and who doesn't. So right off the bat, first person off, not much of a surprise, just considering his cockiness a bit, is John. John jumps off for once Jeff decides to tempt the group with candy. John jumps off. You know, it was only 7 minutes. He was complaining very little, but, you know, after he jumped off, I think he was just relieved, and I think he felt he was complaining. I love the fact that Keith called him out a bit. I also think that if John really was a fan of Survivor and knew a lot about Survivor, he probably should have realized that Jeff was going to offer much better options than a candy bar. Later on in the competition, you know, the women seemed to be the ones that were at first like wanting chocolate and candy, and he was the one that jumped off. I think that says a lot about the women on this team having the perseverance, at least at that time, and a lot about John. So John's the first one out. Love the fact that Keith called him out. Keith saying he's 53 years old, John's 26. And you know, John only lasts 7 minutes. Oh my goodness. Anyway, at the 30-minute mark, we cut to the 30-minute mark, and we see that Missy can't take it. So she steps out. We also get a really weird comment from Alex saying, just like Jesus on the cross. I thought that was odd. Anyway, so Missy steps off, and unfortunately, I don't think she got anything out of that because Jeff brings food right afterwards. And yeah, she doesn't get anything out of it, actually. Jeff brings food right afterwards. And after a comment, I believe it was by Wes, if two people jump off, can they share? Probe says, of course, and there just happens to be milk and cookies. And Baylor, who seemed to be fighting so hard for that first half hour, and it seemed like she was in it for the long haul, jumps off along with Jacqueline. They both jump off for 5 chocolate chip cookies, and then they jumped off for some beer. Oh, wait a second. Hey, Joseph Boza. I think you're the first one that's talking here. maybe they did do that early. Joseph Boza on the chat room saying they did that challenge on Survivor knowing that John Rocker would get the early boot. Very possible. Anyway, so let's see. So where are we at? We're at Baylor and Jacqueline jumping off for chocolate chip cookies, 2 glasses of milk. So we cut to 45 minutes ahead, not much longer, and we see Wes being the next person to jump off for food. He jumps off for chicken wings and beer. You know, at least there's protein in that and alcohol. You know, you figure 9 out of 10 times the person that's going to jump off for beer is going to be one of the younger ones. They got to keep that that whole party atmosphere, I think, going. So Wes, you know, I mean, we see what that cost him. I don't know if he would have won the competition, but at least he could have gone for it. So Wes is out. And then we see that Keith brings up the good point. And I'm actually surprised. This was the first time I've really heard Keith say something that was very poignant and strategic in a way. You know, he calls out that Natalie's fighting for her team. He notices that out of the alliance of 5, Natalie is the only one up there fighting, and the rest of the people up there at this point are all the frat boy alliance. They're all fighting for their lives, and I was a little surprised at a couple of things. I was surprised again. You know what? Natalie's the smartest. It just shows that Natalie right now, I think, is the smartest person on that 5-person alliance. We see her later on do something smart. She's the smartest person on that alliance. She is fighting because she sees Reed still on that. On that competition, and Reed's the one they want out, so she's fighting to stay up there with Reed. Everyone else in her alliance totally ignored that and just jumped off for food. So, you know, it's a little surprising to see Natalie up there fighting, and if I was in that position, I think what Keith said really, really is important. Like, I lost my biggest ally in Jeremy, and these are the people I'm grouped up with, and they're not willing to stay on here and fight to get immunity so that we can kick the people we need to kick off. That are the biggest threat right now. Anyway, excuse me. Wes jumping off at that time was really funny because Keith also calls Wes weak. And then, you know, here's the thing. Wes, really interesting. I think this was the perfect episode for Wes to get kicked off because I think he was suffering from some kind of some kind of delirium from being on the island with very little food for too long. He starts talking about about a nugget eating competition where he ate 58 nuggets in 5 minutes for an eating contest. I don't feel like that's the kind of information you want to give to a bunch of hungry survivors, you know, when you're like 20 something days in, on the island. Pretty odd. But, you know, he starts talking about that, and then he starts talking about Probst, about his appearance on 2 and a Half Men when, he was cooking, bacon naked. On 2 and a Half Men. I have not seen that. I think I've heard about that. I haven't seen that episode, but still kind of weird. I think Wes is suffering from a little bit of delirium. He hasn't shown too many smarts. He's kind of been more of a follower. And I think there's been a reason why his edit has been, pretty shallow. Anyway. So Wes is out. We cut to about 1 hour and 20 minutes ahead. Look, this is amazing at this point. I don't know how long I would last, but 1 hour and 20 minutes, holy crap. I don't even know if I'd last 30 or 45, but this is twice as much as that. So 1 hour and 20 minutes in, we see Keith's feet, and oh my goodness, they look, it looks pretty bad for him. It looks like he's definitely not getting circulation down there. His feet are purple, and he's struggling, and he's shaking, and he finally jumps off. And then Alec jumps off shortly after that as well. Neither of them lasting for any food. This battle ends up being a battle between Natalie and Reed, which I think really is almost like a theme for this episode. It seems to be these are the two strategic players right now on the team. Natalie versus Reed. And we cut to from that. That was 1 hour and 20 minutes when we see Keith's feet looking purple and we see Alec out and we could see the pain that they're in an hour and 20 minutes. We cut to 3 hours. We cut like almost three times that length of time. And it's still those two. And we see John and Jacqueline in a food coma, probably sleeping. Again, they just don't show, I don't know, I just feel like it's just not really cool to be sleeping in a challenge when your alliance member is fighting for immunity to keep it away from the one person you probably don't want to have immunity. Natalie ends up doing something pretty smart. I think it just seems obvious that for some reason, somehow Reed is in the zone. Reed will not leave. He is set on staying on there. And Natalie ends up saying she'll jump off for food. Very smart move. I can't just be on here for 3 hours and then just jump off with nothing. So she gets to pretty much order off the menu. I think this is awesome and brilliant. And with all the negotiating that's been going on this season on Survivor, I feel that, you know, to see her do that was spectacular. So let's see. I think I wrote it down. She asked for pizza, chicken wings, a cookie, some water, and beer. So she gets to get a little bit of alcohol and also gets to replenish herself. So, of course, in dramatic style, Jeff tees it up. Natalie stays on for a good half a minute longer, it seems like. Checks Reed out. Reed gives her a wink. And Natalie just knows, you know, there's no way. She was going to crumble anyway. You know, Reed ends up getting immunity. Natalie, who for the most part, I think, was safe no matter what, gets food out of it. So, you know, she busted her ass. And really, both of them really coming out of that competition and just going down on their, you know, Natalie going down on her knees and Reed just having trouble himself just being upright. I don't really get why Reed did the splits, other than I guess it was a stretch, but I felt it was, it was a moment of celebration for him, and I'll give him that. But I also feel like maybe perhaps, you already won an immunity competition and that was really, really hard and really strenuous. You know, you don't want to show too much strength in an immunity competition because that puts the target even stronger on your back. People start wanting to vote you out sooner because they're like, you just play too well in immunity competitions. But so I think that little celebration, maybe, you know, we don't see how it might play out, but I think that kind of adds to the threat that Reed really is in this game at this point. He really is a major threat in this game. Anyway, pardon me. And of course, Natalie gets to eat food. So, I mean, that's great. So let's talk about what happens over Hoyopa post-challenge. So, Reed obviously is going for John. I think a lot of people want John gone for different reasons. And Reed is talking with his frat boys and, you know, he has the team all set up. We see Reed talking also with Missy and Baylor about this. And Missy trusts Reed. Obviously a big mistake, but in this case, it's a big mistake. But Missy seems to trust Reed. Reed seems to be really, really playing really well as far as giving Missy reason to trust him. And obviously they want to get rid of the idol and flush the idol out and get rid of either Wes or Keith. So Missy trusts Reed, but John, surprisingly, John doesn't trust Reed. I actually was a little surprised by this move, but I think we see it. John has been in the driver's seat for the past couple of weeks, and here he is now not trusting anybody because he does not have the deciding vote. He doesn't get to pick and choose what side to be on. Now, I think this is the first time he notices in this episode how much of a target he really is. I think if he knew this before the reward challenge, he probably would have been on that perch a lot longer. Anyway, so John does not trust Reed. However, John seems to trust Alec, which I find a little weird as well. So Alec ends up convincing him to go along with the plan to split their votes between Wes and Keith that would ultimately get John out. Let's just go to Tribal Council. Let's just do that. Tribal Council. So, let's see. The last... Hold on a second. I'm just, it's kind of hard. You got to forgive me, guys, especially people on iTunes who don't know what I'm doing. I'm doing this solo, and I'm obviously talking a mile a minute, trying to slow it down, and I'm also trying to read at the same time a couple of the comments. Thanks a lot to EDM72000 and Joseph Boza for responding on the chat room, talking about the reward challenge. Anyway, so let's talk about Tribal Council. This was awesome. This totally made the show. I really can't wait to see Probst talk about this, like on EW tomorrow, if they put it up or for Thanksgiving or whatever else, because I think there were like definitely some records set here. I feel like I'm not as great on my research from past episodes. I just jumped on this one for today, but this was amazing. So you know, Jeff brings up all the blindsides. We see obviously the two people who got blindsided in Josh and Jeremy, the two strongest players on this game. And we see, you know, we talk about the blind sides. Jacqueline, you know, says that she thinks she's in the five that are strong and she feels confident. Baylor with a big line about trust being big in this game, which obviously we see that in the play. You know, we see a lot of close-ups of John throughout these conversations. And obviously, you know, Survivor, Burnett does such a great job, and his team does such a great job in doing this, you know, trying to figure out if John is actually figuring out, based on any clues that people are accidentally saying, you know, if he's going to play his idol. And, you know, and you know, even hearing lines like Natalie saying, you don't want an idol to be a souvenir, like perfect close up to John. Reed does an interesting move. I really am surprised at this. I don't know if, you know, maybe being on the island 20 something days maybe made him a little, made him do a little misstep here. But I really think that him, you know, knowing Keith and knowing how easily Keith gets, you know, taken aback when people kind of go for him, even strategically, you know, when they're not really going for him, but when they bring Keith up, how he takes things personally. Reed brings up the whole possibility that Wes or Keith have the idol because of Wes jumping off for chicken wings. And, you know, I thought it was a great move from a Broadway actor, Broadway dancer, who obviously is putting on a show. And if only he had a scene partner that could go along with that, but he didn't. He had Keith, and Keith let it slip. Keith let it slip, and Keith said, go with the plan. And what was really interesting, too, at least according to the edits, was even when Keith said stick to the plan, which I'm sure everyone in the audience was like, oh, God, you know, here he comes blowing it. John, the next line is John saying this is the most confusing thing, and I think John still didn't get it, but Reed panicked a little bit. Reed, it was a really one of those tribal councils where you couldn't even, I had to keep rewinding it, honestly. I had to keep rewatching it because I was trying to pay attention to John and other people, but also trying to read the subtitles for what Reed was trying to say to kind of calm Keith down, and also to talk to Natalie to try and say, no, you know, stick with our plan. It was a bit confusing, and you know, good job on the editors, because I think it was just as confusing there probably in person if you were one of the nine that was on that was there, or even on the jury. A lot of confusion. Really, really smart play. We definitely get to see Natalie taking charge. You know, it's, I don't think it's easy to really be in tribal council and be able to try and take command and tell people what to vote for or what to do. So, you know, Natalie, I think, seemed to be the one person, Jacqueline a little bit too before the vote, but they seemed the ones to say, just keep going with the plan, stick with it and stay true. And, you know, of course, I'm sure a lot of people probably thought John was gone at this point, because I kind of like Keith, I just don't see John playing an idol necessarily. I definitely see him more likely to be blindsided, even though he plays smarter than Keith. Anyway, so, you know, they stick with the plan, but really a lot of chaos going on. And just as Jeff goes to tally the votes, Natalie, again, brilliant move. This she's definitely, kudos to her this week in particular for playing such a smart game, telling John that she thinks he should play the idol. And I think it says a lot, considering that that John voted out her strongest ally last week, and, you know, that Natalie wants John gone. And yet Natalie is saving John, and here John is trusting this person that I don't know if he really should trust her, but he's trusting her by getting his idol out and pretty much Natalie saves John. And on one hand, I'm not sure I like that, but we'll get into that. Natalie saved John. Keith, seeing that his plan with Reed is falling to crap, because if John plays his idol, then that means either Keith, whoever gets the 3-4 vote, because I'm sure they didn't know who it was at this point, either Keith or Wes is going to be the next one out. So Keith ends up having to play his idol, which, again, two players I really didn't think either of them would probably play. I really thought they'd both have Sylvan ears at the end of the season. So Keith ends up playing the idol. A quick shot of him trying to give the idol up to his son, which was very admirable. And his son just pretty much saying, no, it's yours. So Keith saves himself. John saves himself. And I really feel like this must be, I mean, we've seen multiple idols played before, but it just seems so amazing to see this. I feel like it definitely, you know, someone getting kicked out this late in the game with only two votes, because I think it was only two votes, just incredible to see that. And with that, Wes ends up going home. I thought it was really funny seeing John's reaction, like, I'm glad I played the idol, when really it was Natalie's plan. So I really thought that was kind of funny. And then, and actually, you know what? A little bit of kudos to John too, because John kind of gave Reed some respect. You know, it was really kind of funny when John goes to Reed, oh, you sly dog, you. Yeah, I really thought that was kind of cool. You don't want to necessarily, you might get pissed off, but you don't want to show it. Necessarily, because once you show that you want to get somebody out this game a lot, it shows weakness as well. So it seemed to be some respect there. And then let's see. And then, yeah, we end up pretty much ending. I will say this, you know, I want to talk about a little bit of Wes's goodbye. but I will say this. This was really, 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 you know, puts Natalie in the driver's seat. We go from seeing a game where no idols have been played to seeing two people who probably, again, I will continue to say this, I don't think they would have played their idols. I think it would have taken a lot for both of them to play their idols. And we see Natalie convince one person to get rid of their idol that saves his life. And then we see Keith have to react, because Keith knew he was going to be going home if he didn't, or Wes was going to be going home if he did not play his idol. So, yeah, so I'm guessing there are going to be two idols in play, but the most brilliant thing right now is Natalie has an idol, and it seems to me that only Baylor knows. I think the question is right now if Baylor is going to tell her mom, if Natalie's going to be okay with that, which I think she would be, as long as John and Jacqueline don't know. Again, Natalie's plan right now is probably to get John out next, and now that John doesn't have an idol, that is great that is great for Natalie. But I really am wondering if she thinks that the Woman Alliance ultimately will really consist with Jacqueline in it. At least, you know, if they have to vote John out, I don't think Jacqueline will be along with it. If John happens to get voted out through Reed or through some other way, I'm sure Jacqueline will join up with the women. So that'll be a very, very interesting thing. I think Natalie's going to have to convince Reed or somebody else to join with her to get John out at this point behind Jacqueline's back. Also, I thought it was funny, out of everybody, John, well, it was only two people who wrote Wes's name down, I believe, two or three, but John spelled Wes's name wrong with two S's. Thought that was really weird. And I loved Wes's comments at the very, very end, which was, you know, you got to risk it to take the biscuit. Talking about the chicken wings, talking about the beer. So you got to love that. That was pretty funny. I think that's pretty much wraps up this episode. So let's talk about some predictions.
And now, your AfterBuzz TV predictions.
Okay, awesome. So I pretty much said, you know, more or less what I think about Natalie. I think Natalie right now is in the driver's seat out of the whole group. You know, it's going to be really, really interesting to see that. So that was kind of a prediction in itself. I'm trying to think if there's anything. There's a couple things I want to say before I talk about clips from next week, but I want to warn. I'm just trying to think if there's anything else. You know what? Let me talk about how the people are playing right now. because I won't be on probably for the rest of the season. Some of you guys might like that. So right now we have three couples. We have John and Jacqueline. We have Missy and Baylor. Actually, we have two now. John and Jacqueline and Missy and Baylor. Everyone else is a single. So, you know, at this point, I really feel that the smart play would be to get one of the couples out. You know, even though Natalie should have a target on her back because she's such a good player, I think she's still under the radar enough right now that she probably won't be too much at risk at this moment. Reed might be smart to her, but I don't think anyone else necessarily is. John obviously is a smart move. I also, I want to say Missy is also a really smart one to get rid of right now. I think the team, especially the frat boys, they feel that Baylor is not really, they don't really give her much credit for anything. So I think if they were playing somewhat strategically, if I can say that, they would get rid of Missy because, first of all, Missy protects Baylor for everything, and Missy will vote wherever way Baylor goes. And also because I think Missy does not play as strategic game as Missy or Natalie, and without her biggest confidant in the game, I think Baylor is more easily swayed. I think that was probably Josh's biggest mistake in the game, is he kept wanting to try and convince Baylor to be on his side, but he just couldn't sway Missy, and he should have found a way to maybe send some people up against Missy. Having Missy in this game, I think, has really hurt the guys in particular, because she's been so protective of her daughter in particular, and so loyal. Anyway, so I think that's where we're at in the game. I mean, Alec pretty much is a non-factor. Wes was a non-factor. I will say, call out a little bit here. I will say this, that next week's episode, those of you who didn't tune in, we get to see Baylor and Reed getting at it. The challenge looks like I love these challenges where the tribe has to vote who is the worst, who is the loudest, who is this, who is that, and Baylor's going to get a lot of heat. And obviously, it's going to cause a lot of heat with Reed. We also see them teasing another John Jacqueline fight. Will it be something to get rid of John? Will it put Jacqueline on the women's side? I think it's just another one of those little red herrings that makes us think that John's going to go next week. But I think John might be safe for another week. And I'm kind of like, you know, John and Reed right now seem to be the most fun people to watch on this game. Natalie is the smartest one in this team. So anyway, God, I hope you really liked the past 50 minutes with me. I'm surprised I talked this long for so long about this show, but I do love it. I hope you guys got a lot out of it. You know, next week, the show will probably be back on its regular time with Justin, Jerry, Ryan, some combination of those three. Otherwise, if you want to talk to me about Survivor or about my other AfterBuzz shows, Walking Dead, Scorpion, Blacklist, or Homeland, feel free to tweet me at Nandovell, or you can catch me on those shows. You can catch a bunch of shows here in AfterBuzz. Please rate us. We love 5 stars, and thank you so much, and tune in next Thursday for another episode of Survivor. Thank you.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.